Let us define a category. So we define category via directed graphs. So consider these vertices, these rust color blobs. So these we will call object of the category. So if your category is C, these will be objects of the category. So let us just name them. Say this is object A of the category, object B of the category, object C of the category. So between these objects, there are some morphisms. So say this is F. So these arrows we are going to call as morphisms. So we are just drawing something. Say this is G, and say this is H. And that is all what is needed to start defining a category. So a category C consists of the following data. So this is some category, say C. So it contains a class of C called the object of the category. So for example, A, B, C are objects of the category. For each pair A comma B, so this pair A comma B, we have a set home A to B. This is also denoted as C A B, whose elements are called morphisms or arrows from A to B. So this F is actually an element of this, or home A comma B. So the arrow goes from domain to codomain. So the domain of this arrow F is A, and the codomain of this arrow F is B. So notice that we are writing here this as a set. So in general, this is not a set, this is a class. But for our purposes, we will always denote this set of arrows as a set. So home AB will always be a set. So again, notice that you have a class here, not a set. And you have a set here, not a class. But in general, you have this as a class. So number three of category is for a triple ABC of objects. So for a triple ABC of objects, there is a composition law. So home AB composed with home BC gives you home AC. So this is just composition. That is, you have pair FG, you can compose them. So you first go F and then you and go G. So notice that G is part of home BC. So or C BC. So that is home of BC. And the composition law, this is written as like this. You first apply F and then you apply G. So first apply F and then you apply G. So this is what the composition law is. And for every object A, there is an identity morphism. So for every object, we have morphisms like this. So this is identity on C. This is, say, identity on B. And then you have here identity on A. So these four conditions are subject to some natural conditions. So first is associativity axiom. So say you're given F and G. So F and G are exactly like this. F is an arrow from A to B and G is an arrow from B to C, and H is an arrow from C to D. So you have another arrow H from C to D. So then you can go first GF and then H. So first GF and then H. This is same as first going F and then going H composed with G. So notice that this here, you first go G and then you go H. So you have G and then H. So you're going from A to D. So either you can traverse this route, which is first F and then H composed with G, this route, or you can go this route. So which is first GF and then H. So it doesn't matter which route you take. The second one is the identity axiom. So for identity axiom, we focus on a particular object. So for every object we have to consider. So we will focus on this B. So there are arrows coming into B, which is F, and there is arrow going out of B, which is G. So if an arrow comes into it, F, you can compose it with 1B and you are still the same. So F comes in and then you compose it with 1B, you should end up at the same position. So 1B composed with F is F. So 1B composed with F. Similarly, you have an arrow going out of it. So first you apply identity on B and then you apply the arrow G, which is the same thing. So kind of natural. So this identity should act the way we want it to act. So it should not change the arrows coming into object P and going out of object P. So the identity should not change any of these arrows. Now at the start, we said that this number two, this is in general a class. But we, in this set of lectures, we will focus on this as a set. So if you want to call this a set, then this is a locally small category. So if you have a general definition of category, this will be a class here and you will have a class there. And if you want to replace this class with a set, you call it a locally small category. So this is a set. That is same as saying home AB is a set. Now, if objects are also sets, so this objects are a class, but if they are also sets, in addition to this being a set, then you call it a small category. And finally, we talk about a subcategory. So you have a subcategory C prime, which lies in C. Now it has the same set of objects as bigger category. Its morphisms are also a subset of the bigger category. It takes identity and composition law from the bigger category. So kind of natural subset of the bigger category C. Now we do some examples. So you have a category of sets, objects are sets, and morphism are maps between sets. So notice that this is a very important example because, you know, there is no set of all sets. So that will lead to Russell's paradox. And that's precisely why we need category, because we don't even talk about sets. We talk about class. So you have a class. So you do not have set of all sets, but you have a class of sets. So another example, standard example, is category of groups. Objects are groups and morphisms are homomorphisms between groups. Then you have rings. Objects are rings and morphisms are ring homomorphisms. Then you have modules. Objects are R modules and you have R module homomorphisms. Then you have matrices. Objects are natural numbers and then morphisms are matrices. So easy to see, I mean, say you have morphism from 3 to 4. So the way you want to see it is that, you know, this, you have this vector space V3 to V4. And the way you can go from here to here is via a matrix multiplication. So you multiply by 3 by 4 matrix. So this is the object. So instead of V3, you're going to write 3 as object, V4, 4 as an object. Because V is kind of standard everywhere. And this matrix, which takes this to this, is the morphism of the category. So now we have topological spaces, we have open sets and continuous map. You can have this open sets and homotopic maps, so H top. Then you can have pre-sheaves on some space X. You have pre-sheaves on X, sheaves on X, and the morphisms in both the cases are just morphism of pre-sheaves. So some more examples of categories. So a partially ordered set, this can be viewed as a category. You know, the objects are elements of the set S and the set of morphisms or arrows. So this is just a singleton if you have this and it is empty otherwise. So you have this, so this is your morphism. And obviously this is not, this is an empty set. There's not, this relation does not exist. So less than equal to, you're making a morphism. Now category C op, everything is same as C, but the arrows are reversed. So you have objects are same, morphisms are same, everything is same, just that the arrows are reversed. Now a discrete category is one whose only morphisms are identities. So they're just identity morphisms. So you have this object A, you have identity on A, you have object B, you have identity on B, and so on. There's no connecting morphisms. Now a small category with only one object, this is a monoid. And this makes a group into a category. So the morphisms are elements of the group which we compose. So you have this one object and then you have morphisms. So say you have G1 and then you have G2 and then you can compose G1 and G2, because you can composing G1 and G2 will again take you to star. So you can have this, which is G1 composed with G2. So this again G1 composed with G2 lies again in the group. So all these arrows from object to itself, these are all morphisms. So this is the object and the rust color are the arrows. Now finally we have the category of relations. Now the objects of this category are sets, and the morphism between two sets A to B is a relation. So by a relation we mean a subset B cross A. So composition of relations, you have from A to B you have relation R, from B to C you have relation S. So this is given as, obviously you composed first R and then S, so you have A and C. So CA, so CA obviously this, so this lies in A cross C because this relationship is going from A to C. And so we have to filter via B. So there exists some B that you have CB in S. So you have this relationship here. So that is C cross B, and obviously then you have to go to B cross A. So these were the examples. So the two references for this is Handbook of Categorical Algebra. So this is written by Borsiu, and the second one is Heda's book on ellipticals and arithmetic invariants.